Welcome to Your Berks History, Berks History Center's monthly program on BCTV. My name is Benjamin Neely. I'm the Executive Director of the Berks History Center, and I'm also your host for today's program. And I'm joined by Associate Director Alexis Campbell and our curator, Amber Vroman. Now, we're all filming from our home locations because the Berks History Center does remain closed to the public at this time. But we've been working to continue fulfilling our mission by offering both a combination of digital experiences as well as in-person experiences. And that's actually what our program is about today. And I'd like to get started with one of the wonderful initiatives that we have that's really benefiting the community, and that's our Victory Garden program. And we've been calling it Berks History for Victory. And I wonder, Alexis, if you could get us started with that by talking a little bit about, you know, what was the inspiration behind that and how did that program got up off the ground?
Sure. So like many organizations, when we closed to the public, we kind of ran to go online, as many other organizations did. And that really got us thinking as we were, you know, preparing in our website and getting videos and content up on our social media. We were thinking, how can we actually serve our community in a way that would be really relevant to what's going on right now? And so we, you know, I had some conversations with Amber and you and other staff at the History Center, and we just thought that Victory Gardening, if we look back in history, was one of the things that they did during World War I and World War II that really was a community effort, but also a response to a crisis. And so we, you know, kind of took that inspiration and thought it would be a great way to get folks involved with something they could actually do at home themselves and didn't involve being in front of a computer screen. So we launched the project in mid-March, and I'm going to pull up some photos of what we did for the project. Right. So here is the plants that we put together. We had over 1,000 vegetable plants. We had a nice combination of tomatoes and pepper plants that we were able to order from local greenhouses and suppliers. And so we put them together in these little kits for our plant giveaway. And we put together 250 of them. And then on the giveaway day, I believe it was May 11th, and there's our staff and volunteers who were all had their masks on, and we're trying to social distance appropriately for the plant giveaway. But these are the kits that we gave away. They're little pepper plants and tomato plants, and all this community information. So we put together a short history of Victory Gardening in America, and there's also some other resources in there from the Reading Public Library, from the Master Gardeners, from Muhlenberg Green Architects put together a very nice build your own Victory Garden instruction kit there, and all those things were included in the kits. In addition to that, we also installed a demonstration garden on the grounds of the Berks History Center, and you can see us installing it here with Berks History Center staff and some family members that came to help us with that installation. And there's the final garden bed in the front there that was put in. And we also have one right in the front near our free library. So the layout of the bed basically tries to mimic what was done for the actual Victory Garden. So we're actually trying to demonstrate that, you know, how these things would have actually looked during World War I and World War II. Ours is a little unique because of its location, right on the corner of the sidewalk there. But people really did dig up whatever space they could during that time. So anywhere from, you know, community parks, any public space, the city made it available. They actually tilled the soil and made garden plots available to residents. So it's really kind of a throwback to that time period where people were just kind of pitching in and getting the resources that they could put together to be able to grow food and support their families. Hmm. So if you have a chance, please stop by and visit the Berks History Center garden. We really hope that folks have a chance to to come and see what we've done on the lawn of the Berks History Center at 940 Center Avenue. We are still closed to the public, so we're not inviting folks in just yet, but it's a great educational space. Amber had put together some very nice exhibit signs there, so there's a lot to learn just by visiting the garden.
That's true. And you guys put together some videos that we can find on Facebook.
Yes. So we have a whole campaign going online in addition to the regular things that we're posting about Berks County's history. Both Amber and I are sharing our own stories from home. We're all kind of cooped up. So gardening at home has been a fun outlet for us, certainly for me. So we've been sharing our own videos, our own photos, and then we also have the Berks Victory Gardeners Facebook page. And there's a whole community of people in there, people that are gardening from home. They're sharing photos, sharing information. I saw somebody posting, like, what is this, you know, pest that is eating my cabbage plant? And people were on there sharing, you know, you could treat it with this. It might be this. And it's really a nice way to connect with others in the community and then also just have access to those resources. I heard saw some people swapping seeds on there, swapping plants. So it's a really nice community space.
That's great. I'm really excited about this project from the beginning. I thought it was a great way to show how relevant that the Berks History Center's mission was, even in this midst of this health crisis. And I was really glad we could do this for the community. And really, it was kind of an emotional thing. Some of the folks that showed up for the program really were in need. And they were so grateful for the kits and the information on how to get started. So just congratulations to both of you and the others that helped get this going. I think it's just a wonderful program. And it shows that we're trying to strike a balance between that, you know, still doing something, like as you said, away from the screen, getting you out of the house a little bit. But we've balanced that also with continuing to do digital initiatives as well. And if we could talk about that for a moment, we do have a lot of digital programs and experiences going on online. And one of the things we've taken, one of our flagship programs has been Second Saturdays. And we have taken that virtual with the help of Herbine and Company, allowing us to borrow their Zoom webinar account. We did our first program in May online, second Saturday, with Paul Dresba doing History of Memories of Carsonia Park, and that was really well received. It's all new for us trying to do that, as it is using Zoom to record this show, and we learned some things. We're trying it again in June, and one of our board members, the intrepid Brian Engelhardt, has stepped forward to do another program for us. And this will be June 13th at 10 a.m., and you can go onto our website, berkshistory.org, to find more. But the program is Stop It, Mr. Mayor, the Shotgun Resistance of the Maiden Creek Dam. So we hope that you'll be able to join us for that. Currently, we are not charging for our Second Saturday programs. As we are learning how to use this technology, we invite you to join us on that Saturday, and we can fit just about as many people who will show up for the program. So we'll hope to see a lot of folks there, and we're grateful for Brian to continue this experiment with us. But we've also, on our website, you'll find Berks History at Home. And there's a lot of different resources. And I wonder, maybe Amber, could you talk a little bit about that and some of your contributions to that? What kind of materials we might find there at Berks History at Home?
Well, I know that for the most part, the content on the Berks History from Home was created by our archivist, McKenna Britton, but I will touch on some of the things that she came up with. She digitized coloring book pages from a coloring book that has drawn images of scenes in Berks County and Redding. She has also put together an initiative for our followers to create a shoebox archive at home with some of their own family items. Just to have different videos that were taken by some of our other team members, some of our staff members, and just a variety of different things.
And I think we have a video to run in the program that's actually from McKenna Britton, our archivist, kind of talking about her shoebox archive.
Hi there, this is McKenna Britton, the archivist at the Berks History Center, and I just wanted to spend a few minutes talking about our shoebox archive project. So this project was pretty heavily inspired by my own personal tendencies to collect my family's history.
I pulled from my past experiences
with my grandparents and my parents, going through their albums and picking out some pictures. They were excited that I showed an interest in keeping them and preserving them for the future. It was a really special experience, so I thought that why not encourage other folks who are currently quarantined and are at home to create their own mini archive. So for the project, it's called a shoebox archive, but you don't necessarily need a shoebox. You can kind of use whatever you have available to you. So a few examples, I have an Amazon Prime box that you can sort of revamp. You can take off the stickers, you can paint it, paste pictures on it, whatever you want to do. It's could be a very fun craft idea and project to do with the kiddos. Even like a smaller box is fine. This one is a little tiny one that I painted sky blue that you can use. I have this old suitcase that I got, and it is where I keep all my goodies, and I'll go through some of that with you today to show you some of the things that you can be collecting. So as you're gathering materials, some of the questions that you can be asking as you're going through the materials are, what is the memory that I have associated with this? Why do I have a desire to preserve this for the future? What will this story tell future family members about our family, about, you know, my mom, about my grandma? What can I share with them through this material? As you're going through pictures specifically that you do want to pull out and set aside for your shoebox archive, feel free to identify them, and you can write the identification and perhaps some key words that will help you sort of remember the story behind them or the details of the picture itself. You can write those on the back of the photo, but make sure to write them in pencil. You don't want to write them in pen. This one, for example, tells me that I was 3 months old in this photo with my father, but it is written on there with black ink, which is not the recommended method for archives and for archival standards. So you can write on there the name of the family member, the year if you know, and any sort of information. Was it at a wedding? Was it at a Thanksgiving dinner? You can write all those things on the back there so that when you are going through it in the future, you will know the story behind it and you'll be better able to share that story with your family members. When you are filling these shoeboxes up, you will want to keep the objects laid flat, preferably, if you can, and you can also store them vertically as well, but try to make sure that they're not bent and smushed in there. This one would be really good for my older pictures because the older photos are a lot smaller. So this here is my grandma, and it says that it's from Christmas 1960, and this one would fit really well in the bottom of this box here. Another thing that you can do to sort of ensure the safety of the photos themselves is to just get some tissue paper that you would use to wrap gifts, and you can sort of lay it at the bottom, and as you're layering photos in your shoebox archive, you can use that as a separator in between. Now I'll sort of show you some of the other examples of things that you may want to put in your shoebox archive are old letters. So this is a letter that my father wrote his mother. You can even collect playbills or programs from events. When I was in second grade, we put on a play. These kinds of things can be fun because they have other information within them about what was going on at the time. So this is from 2003. It says, McKenna Britton is a veteran entertainer. She portrayed the bell ringer in The Little Bell That Couldn't Ring and performed in the play When Santa Bowed at Christmas. McKenna likes to read, do her homework, and wear cool clothes. Her future ambition is to become an artist and a teacher. She has invited her mom, sister, grandpa, and grandma to see her performance this evening. In terms of artifacts, if you have them, feel free to put them in there. They are by no means necessary. The library at the Berks History Center is a primarily paper-based archive, and then the museum has the majority of tangible objects and artifacts. But I have this pair of shorts, and the story behind this is that they were my father's when he was young enough and small enough to fit in them, and he fringed them himself. So I kept them, and they are in my archive. I have some other items as well, my varsity letters from school, tickets to events. I have medals from 5K races that I participated in. I would go to events and I would spend time with people that I care about, and I would have pictures and things like that, ticket stubs, and I thought, you know, I really want to be reminded of the feelings surrounding this event in the years to come. So I have things dating back to 2003 and things even farther from before I was born, my grandparents' things from 1960. It's like a time machine almost, and it's a really special thing to discuss not only just history in general with your kids and your friends and your family members, but your own personal history and the way that history relates directly to you. And what better way to have that connection with history as a whole and with the past than to create your own shoebox archive. Thank you so much for tuning in to this June episode of BCTV. Again, my name is McKenna Britton, and it was really nice chatting with you all tonight. Stay safe and healthy.
Nice video.
I really like the, you know, bringing it home that we are able to kind of relate what we do at the Berks History Center to the simple things that we have at home, because everybody has those memories that we want to preserve. And I really appreciated McKenna putting that together. It's kind of a simple way that we can be mindful of that, and it might be a fun project to do at home.
Yeah, I encourage people to do that. I don't know. I can't tell you how many people have, you know, tell me that, boy, if I had only thought to do this when I was younger. And they really, really regret it. And so if it's anything that I could get folks to do would be to make sure that they are saving their family's history and properly labeling it and keeping it in a safe place and making sure that it continues to get handed down and added to over the years. That was great. Well, another program we have going on, we have a lot going on in social media, a lot. And I know so many organizations have turned to their social media platform, and we were no different. And there's a lot to look out there, but I really think looking at the content that the Berks History Center is putting up through their social media platforms is really worth your time to look at. There's something new every day. It is very interesting, and a chance to, you know, using the comments to chat with others about their interest with it and connect with people in a way that's safe. And one of the first things I'll bring up that we started with very early was the Museum Moments of Zen. Alexis, what is a Museum Moment of Zen?
That was something that we kind of jumped on the bandwagon with other museums around the country and really around the world. I think when the shutdown happened, we were all in the same boat at the same time. So we were not the only organization online that was sharing things from our collection. And I don't remember exactly what museum it was that originated Museum Moment of Zen, but we were able to get some really nice video clips of our education curator, Vicki Hefner, who it normally gives our school tours and our educational tours and our museum. We got some nice video clips of her going through our different exhibits and sharing some of those fun stories. And we are able to post those online. And that's our Museum Moments of Zen. So we're one of many organizations. If you search the hashtag online, Museum Moments of Zen, you'll find not only the Berks History Center's posts, but hundreds of posts from around the world of different museums that are sharing their collections and their content online. So that's just one of the ways that we can, using the technology that we have. Those videos were just taken on my personal cell phone and then shared on our social media. So we're really doing what we can with what we have, and able to make some really nice content that people have really been enjoying. People have been commenting, saying, I didn't know about the clockmakers in Berks County. And I do have one of those videos as well, and I would love to share it with you. And this one relates to the Berks women's suffrage movement that is going on this year. 2020 is the 100th anniversary of the passing of the 19th Amendment in Berks County and beyond, I'm sorry, all through America. Berks County focused. But in Berks County, we are actually made a concerted effort to acknowledge that this year. And the Berks Women's History Alliance formed at the beginning of last year, and they really said, we really want to make sure that 2020 doesn't pass without us acknowledging this historic event. Our plans have changed a little bit because of the shutdown. So, but I do want everybody to know that we are still celebrating. So I'm going to share this video with Vicky sharing about the Justice Bell, which we were really thankful that the Justice Bell was actually able to come to the Berks History.
Hi, Vicki Hefner, Education Curator at the Berks History Center, and I'm standing right next to a replica of the Justice Bell. We were very excited this past March to be part of the Justice Bell Foundation travels with the replica of the Justice Bell. Unfortunately, it arrived here right as we shut down, but we are anticipating the bell being here through the end of June. And hopefully the Berks History Center will reopen in time for you to come visit the Justice Bell. The Justice Bell was, the original Justice Bell was made in 1915, and it traveled to all 67 counties in Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania was the only state to do something like this. It traveled to all of the counties throughout the state. The ringer on the bell has been stabilized, and the women would talk about suffrage and their right to vote. And the thought was that the clapper would not be rung until women gained the right to vote. One of the smart things that they did is they traveled the bell on the back of a truck, and it was a new kind of truck, so the men would come out to see the truck, and they had a captive audience, and they could talk to them about the 19th Amendment, their right to vote. And fortunately, women gained the right to vote in 1920. The amendment was ratified on August the 26th, 1920, which today is now known as National Equality Day. The Berks History Center is especially thankful to the Berks Women's History Alliance, which formed about 2 years ago. It was a follow-up to an organization known as the Berks County Commission for Women, which disbanded after their 20th anniversary a few years ago. The core group of that commission started meeting and decided that they did not want the 100th anniversary of the passing of the 19th Amendment to go back, to go by with no celebration. And in fact, the women involved with the replica of the Justice Bell has said that Berks County is the leader in Pennsylvania and appears to be doing the most in the state to do this celebration. So many thanks to the Berks Women's History Alliance, along with the Berks History Center. There was a financial agreement, and we were able to bring it here and raise the money so that we could celebrate the 19th Amendment with the Justice Bell.
That's great.
That is just one of many videos of our Museum Moments of Zen, and many others types of videos that we're sharing on our Facebook page, on Twitter, On our YouTube page and also on Instagram. So there's many different channels where folks can tune in. It's all at Berks History, and they can get on there and see those videos.
That's great. Amber, could you tell everybody at home watching why Mondays might be a great day to check in on our Facebook page?
Mondays are a great day for our followers on all of our social media platforms. Just this past week, which would have been the 25th of May, I'm attempting to do is every Monday post a close-up photograph image of an object from our collection. So it'll be a zoomed in picture that people then have to guess in the comments what the object is. And so the hope is that basically it's a fun way to interact with the public and in a guessing game of what these objects are. And then by Tuesday at the exact same time, the photograph of the entire image or object is posted with a little bit of history about what the object is and its provenance. So the hope is that while we're closed, I can bring a bit of content about the museum's collection on exhibit, some of the objects we have on display while people can't come see them. And then eventually once we open, it'll be a way to sort of bring to light objects that are in our behind the scenes storage areas. So very excited to continue that. And it seems that people were excited to sort of participate. So
that's great. I hope everybody has an opportunity to get in there and make a guess. And don't worry about being wrong. There's no scores and we don't judge. It's all for fun. We've got our own content, but we've also have an opportunity to partner with Americana Fest, which, you know, I'm still new to the area and getting caught up to speed on things. And this would have been my first opportunity to go to some of these events like Americana Fest, but it's gone virtual. And we've been invited to participate and bring some of our content to that platform. And so we'll be participating. And I think one of the things we're really excited to do is move our Berks County Rock and Roll Hall of Fame induction ceremony to Americana Fest. And again, this was going to be my first induction ceremony. And now we're going to have to do this by Zoom and figure out how we're going to record this and release this online. Alexis, for people like me that have never been to an induction ceremony, what's that going to be like?
Sure. Our induction ceremony is usually a pretty good party. So it's kind of a bummer that it's going to have to be digital. But hopefully when people tune in on Americana Fest, which the date that will be airing is June 12th at 6:30 p.m. And that's can be found on Facebook at Americana Fest. So when that airs, we hope that people, you know, make it a little happy hour in celebration of the folks that are being inducted, because Berks County really does have some incredible musicians. We have an incredible music history and music culture here in Berks County. And that is, you know, one of the many things that the Berks History Center celebrates and we do that through our Berks County Rock and Roll Hall of Fame exhibit and project. So we have the exhibit at the Berks History Center where we induct folks every year. And this year, I don't remember the exact number, but maybe about 20 inductees. And we have a committee now that they actually help us to identify folks in the community who are really active and have that rich history working in the music industry here in Berks County. So we tried to get people from all generations. So from the 50s through the 90s, we have representatives of all areas, and those folks are gonna be added to the Berks County Rock and Roll Hall of Fame this year on our virtual induction ceremony on Americana Fest on that Friday then.
Oh, that's great. It's good that we were able to find some way to continue it, you know, and hopefully next year we'll be back to our regular in-person ceremonies and join a nice party together with some good music. But one of our last programs we really want to highlight for the show today is our COVID-19 project. It's a collections project. And Amber, can you talk to us a little bit about what that program entails? What are we trying to capture in that project?
Certainly. So just a little bit of background as to how the project was really sort of thought of in the first place. Being that we're an organization that has been around for 150 years and we've been collecting for almost just as long, there are thousands and thousands of objects in our collection. However, specifically during the 20th century, there were certain aspects of history that our forefathers, in a sense, didn't necessarily feel were important at the time to collect items or stories for it, for posterity's sake. So essentially, my thought with this project is that we could collect objects pertaining to how the community reacted to the COVID-19 pandemic, experiences they sort of went through, whether it be quarantined at home or businesses that sort of took to the front lines to really help the community, that we could preserve those stories and those objects, not necessarily for anything we would be doing today, but for our generations of the future, of the organization, to be able to exhibit and interpret those stories 50, 150 years from now. So essentially, what we're interested in, sort of what I mentioned earlier, would be experiences, any experience. I mean, some people will feel that their story or what they've lived through at this time isn't exciting enough or important enough to share. However, everybody's story matters. And while we can't necessarily collect everything, we would love to be able to sort of mesh out and sort of weed through what it is the public and our communities were doing and were experiencing during this really extraordinary time, because it really is something that we're going to be talking about for years and years and even generations from now. So really, it would just be great for anybody to share their story.
They can go to our website.
Yes, so we created a survey. Alexis can probably explain that a little better, but there is a survey that people can go online and take, and essentially, it at this time, while we're not open, it allows you to basically digitally share your story and let us know if there's anything that you might be interested in donating to us once we do open back up to the public, which could be anything from diary or journal entries that you've been keeping during this time, or if you've written a song about your feelings during this time, or if you've created artwork in some way, or for those businesses that did specific things like create face shields or hand sanitizers, or just sort of took to the front lines to take the call in helping the community. There's just various aspects, or even just oral histories, anywhere from family dynamics to the experiences our children were going through as they didn't get to finish school from home. Teachers love to hear from them as to how the remaining years of their school or months of their school year sort of played out as they had to still educate their students from home. Basically, even activities that families might have decided to do together that sort of took back to activities of our older generations, sitting around and having dinner together or playing board games. Just things that we did that we haven't done before this pandemic, or like what you've done to get outside and be active that you might not have done before this. We had a lot more time to do things, even though it's such a crazy time, our daily lives sort of did really slow down and allow us to take a moment to really put in perspective what is important and what we can do that we just didn't have the time to before. So it's essentially just collecting that that experience community-wide. So
That's a great reminder that we are all living through a historic moment. And it's something to be mindful of when you think about what you wish your ancestors had written down at a particular period of time. This is your opportunity to do that so that your descendants will know a little bit about you, and make sure that you let your family know that your story resides at the Berks History Center for posterity. Thank you both for joining in the show and helping put together the June program here. And this brings us to the end of our show. And to wrap up, I'd like to thank you all for tuning in to today's program. It's been real special for us to be able to find different ways to reach out and connect with our audience. This has been a challenging time for the Berks History Center, as many organizations are facing difficulty now. We're no different, and we're not permitted to open until the county moves to the green phase of our recovery. And even then, there's going to be restrictions on our operations and what we're able to do. And we'll open when it's safe. We will follow the guidelines of the CDC and the Pennsylvania Department of Health. But during this time, our team is really focused on how we continue to serve our members and the Berks County community at large by continuing to preserve our local history and to share it with all of you. That's why we do what we do. And this has us working harder than ever from our homes. And currently, we have no visitors, no regular income to sustain the organization. And we have been really humbled by the ongoing support of our membership, especially the many who have renewed or even made an extra gift on top of their membership to help carry us through. We're making sure that the Berks History Center will continue on as it has for the past 150 years, maintaining our staff and the expertise that they bring. We have secured some support through the CARES Act to help us continue on, and we also look for additional support through grant funding institutions. But your membership and your donations have never been more important than they are right now. So many people have been negatively impacted by this, but if you can, please give generously to the Berks History Center. And thank you once again for joining us for your Berks history. And from the entire team at the Berks History Center, we wish you good health and safety.